Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Ronald here, and welcome to a belated Wednesdays with the Colonel. It's actually now Friday with the Colonel for this week, because it was Wednesday, you were busy, Thursday, I was busy, and now none of us are busy because it's weekend. So yeah, but anyway, my name is Chris, and this is Ronaldo. How's it going?
Make sure you pronounce my name correctly. It's Ronaldo Goes.
Goes, yeah. And mine is Chris. Chris Vitt. Mine is Chris.
Yeah, there you go. No, it's going well. I am not busy. I carved out this time so we could do the show because people appreciate it. So I've been swamped. Even my role as judge of elections, I'm still doing things. I'm not even the judge of elections, the veteran service organization.
Yeah, you can't be there anymore, surely.
Well, no, not for this election. I have to step out. And when I win in April, then I'll be out in November, too. But if I didn't win in April, then I would be the judge in November, which
well,
is
I mean, you can
just chaos.
Just still keep it. I mean, just do the...
I just recuse myself. That's all. Just like
no,
a judge.
No. What I'm saying is just be the judge of elections.
I could be the IEC. Then I know I'll win for sure.
Exactly. By the way, for those of you, look how cool this glass is. This is shaped like a can. So like a
Pepsi, a Coke can.
Like a Coke can, and you can get it at Westpac. It's like 50 Rand for three. It's very cool. It's shaped like an actual Coke can or Pepsi can.
Very, 50 very Rand? Cool. I used to be able to buy, you know, half a pound of meat, a loaf of bread, some milk, and some spices for 50 Rand.
True that. Anyway, so what's news on your side? I've been so busy with just... keeping up with resident issues. I know probably that a bunch of bullshit has been said by a bunch of politicians. Let me just think of one quickly. I know that Floyd Chivambu has been moved from KZN because he's been doing such a sterling job over there. And I think the start of cracks within the EFF is starting to show, because Floyd is the second most powerful person in the EFF. And I mean, you and I have both said this for a very long time, that the cracks will eventually start showing. And this is what's happening now. That is what's going on, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, absolutely. The problem with the EFF is that EFF is Julius Malema. That's it. And they have nothing.
Well, the problem
they have
is
no
the
bench.
EFF. As
well, no,
EFF,
but I'm saying, I'm talking about the existence of the party. If there's no Julius Malema, the EFF fractures and falls apart. I mean, COPE wouldn't exist if, and there's not much of COPE left, but it wouldn't exist if Terra Lakota didn't exist. It just wouldn't exist. It's the same sort of thing. The PA would not survive without Gate McKenzie. These are parties based on
personality.
What some people, personalities, what some people think are charismatic personalities. I wouldn't agree in any of those cases, but the point is that they exist for that reason. And MK exists entirely because it got endorsement from Jacob Zuma. Without Jacob Zuma, they would be doing nothing, and that's why
the
ANC is so terrified.
Court case, though, because I mean, I don't look. You won't
Which
find
court
me
case?
Agreeing.
There's two of them.
So there's so many, but I'm talking about the MK party one, whether it should exist or not. The ANC court case. What's his name? Dalia Mpofu said actually rings quite true in the sense that. He says that the reason the ANC started taking note and started objecting because of MK's existence is the moment that Jacob Zuma put his support behind the MK party. Now, I mean, what is your feeling on the MK party, by the way? Like, do you want them to exist? I mean, okay, let me rephrase, because I don't think it's good for South Africa for the MK party to exist under Jacob Zuma. But do you think that they should contest the election, or do you think that the IEC should remove them?
Well, that's complicated. And the short answer is I think the IEC should allow them to continue to contest the election. Now, the problem with this is that the ANC's motivation isn't that they filled out the paperwork wrong, which is their argument. That's a technicality, because they ignored MK. It had already filled it out. They were approved. They were going to contest. The ANC knew that, but they dismissed them. But when Zuma aligned with them, suddenly they care. So the ANC are just hypocrites and they're frauds. If they're really concerned about the sanctity of the process, they would have addressed this when the application went in and it was supplemented rather than the new application. So, I mean, they should be allowed to it. As far as whether it's good or bad for South Africa, it's not good for South Africa, but it's horrendous for the ANC. And I love it. I love it. I have no problem with MK being out there contesting the election. I mean, this is great. It further accelerates the implosion of the African National Congress. Now, I'm not foolish enough to believe that they won't kiss and make up. If MK gets 13% of the vote and the ANC gets 30% of the vote or more, they will align with each other. I mean, they're birds of the same feather. Nothing's going to change. Cope won't come back to help the ANC because Terry Lakota is still bent out of shape about how Thabo Mbeki was dismissed by the party, and rightly so. But you have enough little parties out there that can glom on, that will betray South Africa, like the Patriotic Alliance. You've got others out there like Al Jamaa. I don't think they're going to do well in this. But the point is, it's whatever happens, I see South Africa being the Italy of the 21st century. Italy's had 69 governments. They've collapsed endlessly, endlessly. And back in the 1970s, 80s, you turn around a couple of days later, the government collapses. They got to have another vote and form another coalition. I think that's what's going to happen in South Africa. And that's very disturbing because that will paralyze governance. It will paralyze economic growth in a way even worse than the ANC simply stealing everything. At least you can blame the ANC. When that happens, anybody involved in the coalition is going to be blamed. I mean, look what happened to the DA in Nelson Mandela Bay, in Shwane, in Joburg, getting blamed for failures of administrations before them. Then they leave and the changes they made take effect and the people who replace them claim credit for something they never did. It's not a recipe for success.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I know that the DA is on Monday at 11 o'clock announcing their candidates list, so which means they'll make that publicly available. And yeah, I mean, I watched your video. It's very insightful with regards to the various different options available. I don't think that the MK... I mean, Jacob Zuma actually came out a couple of days ago and pretty much said that, you know, his goal and the goal of the MK is to realign the ANC. He said it. Like, he said it out there for everybody that thought that it wasn't, because Jacob Zuma can't stand as the presidential candidate. He can't serve a third term. So he can be a member of parliament, but I mean, he thinks that that's beneath him. I mean, because then he'll actually have to work a little bit. So the entire goal, like I said, and I'm pretty sure you said it too, of the MK is just to get rid of Cyril Ramaphosa. As soon as they get rid of Cyril Ramaphosa, then they will align with whomever in the ANC. They just don't want Cyril Ramaphosa. So you can bet your bottom dollar that that MK and the ANC will form a coalition after 2024 election, as long as Cyril Ramaphosa is not the leader of the party. And we all know how easy those members of parliament will bend over backwards for their supper. So yeah, expect a vote of no confidence coming pretty soon.
No, absolutely. Look, the birds of a feather. It's just part of the ANC. It's a bum hurt part of the ANC. That's what MK is. They stand for nothing. They have nothing realistic. Although we see they're squatting in you know, buildings in Joburg and Heilbronn now. They're being accused of that. That's pretty funny. But Bevan Weber says, you guys are so convinced the ANC will fall below 50%. I don't see how they still fall more than 7.5%. They will fall, yes, but no matter how, because people still vote for them. Listen, Bevan, I made a projection, and I stand by it, in the first week of November of 2021 when the ANC was crushed in municipal elections. The ANC is rightly seen. See, if you look at national elections, you've got to look at Gauteng and you've got to look at KZN. These are the two most populous provinces, and their impact is huge on national elections. You have to look at what happens. And in the 2020 municipal elections, the ANC was crushed in KZN because of their internal insurrection and the open lawlessness that happened in July 2021. Months later, they were punished. People are still suffering from that. Those voters are not coming back to the ANC. Look at the by-elections. People are voting for MK not because they like it, but because they hate the ANC and KZN. The ANC will become a minority party in KZN in this election. They will be lucky to get 20%. That's going to have a major impact on their national total. In Gauteng, Action SA, the DA, and others have cut into the ANC. The ANC will be a minority party there as well. They barely won it last time in 2019 with 52% or 51% of the vote. There's no way that they get it. And bear in mind the following, folks, and I'll be done in a second, Ronaldo. Mm-hmm. Bear in mind the following. 2019 national election didn't have load shedding every sick and frickin' day. It didn't have billions and trillions of PPE theft. It didn't have the destruction of the tourism industry and the hotel industry and hospitality industry and restaurants because of stupid decisions in load shedding, and not load shedding, in COVID. None of that was in play back then. Also, we have 8 years of no promises, or promises that have borne no fruit. Cyril Ramaphosa's $100 billion of foreign direct investment. South Africa is a net loss of foreign direct investment in the time he's been president. So listen, I appreciate that you say people are going to vote for him, but a lot of black voters have had enough. They're the ones living with potholes, and they've only ever known ANC rule. So all you need is opposition to get out and be honest with people. Don't say, look, I'm going to bring you this. I'm going to bring you like Patricia Law. I'm going to give you R1,000 of Sasa grant. People know that's BS. Tell them, listen, you see your street I drove in on? Nothing but holes. The ANC has been in charge for 30 years. This street didn't have holes 30 years ago. You don't have electricity. Not because the National Party kept it from you. The ANC put lines up 30 years ago. And guess what? Now they deliver an electric. That's what you have to do. There's no way the ANC gets 50%. No way whatsoever. Whether my projection of 38 to 42%, which is now almost 3 years old, turns to be true or not, we'll see. But that projection, according to the latest Brenthurst survey, is spot on. Doesn't mean I'll be right. Again, I said in November 2021, the ANC will not get any, will get between 38 and 42 at the peak. And I would hope that they get 33 or less. I'm sticking to it.
So, yeah, you've covered most of the aspects. But I think what's different with this national election, because remember, usually the ANC does better in a national election compared to a municipal election, because people mostly want good services, good service delivery on a local government aspect, but they'll still vote for the ANC nationally. I don't know. It's like they don't really understand how it works and how it impacts them. But so you can kind of see how it works in local elections to get a feel for what's going to happen for the national election. Now, as you stated, what is different with this national election is that the ANC hit themselves very hard in the rural communities where people would, 75% or more of them would vote for the ANC. So load shedding, COVID-19, all of these things, the lack of SASSA grant delivery, the failure of delivering SASSA grants on time, all of these things are what's leading everybody to believe that the ANC is going to do worse in this election than what they even did in the municipal elections. I believe it was 48 or 49%. That's what they got in the municipal elections. And if you
46.
Add, sorry, 46%, my bad. So, so what I'm saying is a lot of people projected then that they will get 49 to 48% in the national election. But because of load shedding, because of COVID, because of the lack of SASSA grants delivery, that is going to cause them to do even worse. Now, on top of that, you've got the creation of MK. On top of that, you've got a lot of splinter parties that would chow into the ANC's vote that is now existing. Because usually in the past, what you would see is you would see a lot of splinter parties that would eat into the DA's vote, you know, like COPE, like Action SA. But now you're seeing splinter parties that'll eat into the ANC's vote. So that is why I think 2024 is literally our 1994, because this is the weakest the ANC is going to get. Well, I'm pretty sure that they'll fuck it up even more in the future, but this is pretty much our last hope. So, and if you look at the by-election results, everything is just showcasing that this is going to be a bloodbath. Yeah, I used the term. Yeah. It's going to be a bloodbath for
The ANC will not be the majority party at the provincial level in Western Cape, in Gauteng, or in KZN. The KZN is one that I've recently made a change on because of MK. I didn't think that they would have enough to get to 50% in KZN based on events in 2021, which people haven't forgotten. But with the advent of MK and watching its by-election results, 21%, 28%, 28% in Mpumalanga, which was surprising, I thought, there's no way the ANC retains control of those provinces. So what? They control Northwest, they control, you know, Mpumalanga, they control the Northern Cape, Eastern Cape.
They're not going to control the economy. That's it. No. They're not going to control
The economy is really rooted in Western Cape, Gauteng, where the main part is, and then KZN. That's where the economy comes from. And so, I mean, most of the Southern economy.
Same with tourism. They're not going to control the tourist hub. So the scientists said two things. Well, let me just do this first. Gavin said, Mal S, draw tonight, competition, I'll close. Yes, we'll do a draw in like 10, 15 minutes. For those of you that don't know, we had a fundraiser for Mal. People that entered into that competition got put into a draw for a 2,000 Rand sack sort of hamper. So we're going to do that draw in the next 10 to 15 minutes. But the scientists said two things. Firstly, he said rural areas will still vote for the ANC. Yes, but not as much as what voted in the past.
And not in KZN.
Yes, which is a big chunk of vote. And then he said, secondly, the PA will eat into the DA's vote. Yes, but not as much as what I think everybody is anticipating. Let me tell you why. The PA has done really well in some by-elections. Now, hear me out. Contesting in 5 or 10 or 15 by-elections across the country to inflate your numbers is quite easy because you can throw 50 or 100,000 rand behind each by-election, right? So you can like have community meetings, you can offer them a lot of t-shirts, you can offer them various things, you know, but it's a limited amount of by-elections and then you can shine in those by-elections, right? You can slaughter a cow, you can do this to get the attention. Now, ask yourself whether the PA can do that on a national scale, meaning they can go to thousands of voting districts and replicate that. No, they can't. So a lot of people are anticipating for the PA to do really, really well and eat a massive chunk of the DA support. I don't believe it's going to happen. I believe that, yes, in some areas they'll do very well. Do I think that they'll get a seat in parliament or two? Yes, I do think so. But do you think, or do I think that they're going to completely annihilate the DA? Not at all. I think that they're in for a massive disappointment. And they'll probably end up with one or two seats. And then Gayton McKenzie won't take up that seat in parliament because that's also beneath him.
Well, I think part of the problem here people have to realize is that at the national level, you have to have a ground game everywhere, everywhere. Even in
Yeah.
places where you're not going to win, you've got to get out. The
Provincial
only,
game, at least.
yeah, the only parties that have that kind of reach nationally are the ANC, the DA, the EFF, and that's about it. Action SA is a regional party at this point in Gauteng with a big effort to try to push in KZN. IFP is overwhelming in KZN with a little bit of influence in Gauteng. Freedom Front Plus is concentrated in rural areas in multiple provinces with no major blocks anywhere except in Gauteng and Western Cape. And so not really effective nationwide. Like I couldn't even tell you who a Freedom Front Plus politician is from Nelson Mandela Bay, for example. So these parties don't have the heft. And that hurts them on a national level. The PA doesn't have that either. COPE doesn't have that, you know. So the thing is that nationally, there's only a handful of parties that can actually reach everybody when they need to and get enough workers on the ground to do things. And that's just the reality of it. That has an impact. People don't realize how important it is to be seen. You just walk around with the shirts, with the red Teletubby shirts, or the DA blue, or the ANC green, you know. That's important. And also the posters that go up. It sounds crass, but that does matter. And that's important. And without that ground game, the only people you're going to get are people who are truly interested, who truly think hard about their vote, and then go to the effort to learn about you and your candidates and then pull the lever. But that's a minority of the voting public in any country. And that's a problem.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's going to be an interesting election. I think it's now 68 days away, 66 days away. I
It's
think
close. Speaking of interesting things, I don't know if you noticed my Blitzbox shirt, one of the rare ones that says Steinhoff on it.
yeah. Mark
I actually wore
Rooster.
this. I actually wore this on flight to Vegas, like around the time that the scandal was exposed for the Vegas
Yeah.
Sevens, and they pulled this shirt, and I was one of the few people that had
You
it.
just kept it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's weird because I actually watched a very interesting documentary on Showmax. And by the way, guys, I can't, this is not a paid for promotion for Showmax, but I am absolutely in love with Showmax originals. Not the other shit that they produce, but the Showmax True Crime Originals is phenomenal. And the reason I mentioned that is because there's a Steinhoff documentary called Stein Heist. And then it talks about what happened there. And yeah, I mean, I'm not really sure about the whole Marcus Jooste thing. I know there's a lot of conspiracy theories out there. He was hit with a 475 million rand of like sort of
Judgment.
penalty, the judgment that he had to pay. And apparently the Hawks were getting very close to arresting him. And apparently he committed suicide. I don't know. Yeah, it's weird because I think a lot of people aren't going to believe this suicide until, unfortunately, I think they see some proof, or they're not going to believe anybody.
Oh, there's all kinds of conspiracy theories. My viewers already came on with, the gun was in the wrong hand. It was nowhere near his body. It was the wrong hand, all this stuff. What I can tell you is this. On my first trip back to South Africa after the COVID nonsense, I went to Hermanus and we had to meet and greet Hermanus. And the spot where his life ended, I was there in that exact spot, walking around out there outside my hotel, walked along the coast of that nature reserve there, and I walked that exact spot. I recognized that rock. Wow, that's crazy.
So what is the, because sorry, okay, so I know that he committed suicide. What happened? Can you just tell me where it happened and what is the news surrounding why it happened? I mean, from what I've heard a day or two ago to versus what the latest is
Well,
now.
yesterday. So again, like you said, apparently they were coming to arrest him, and it was unclear. It happened while I was live. The news, News 24 was the first to report it with no details. And then while I was still on air, IOL, Times Live, all of them came out with some of the details. And initially, we didn't know it was suicide; just heard that he was dead. Well, apparently, they claim he committed suicide by walking down there and sitting there, and then shooting himself in the head, I guess. But there was an amateur journalist who went out there and filmed the spot where there's a little bit of blood laying on the rock, and this is all fueling all kinds of conspiracy theories. But of course, for those who don't know what we're talking about, Steinhoff was a multinational conglomerate, a South African slash German company that owned furniture businesses and many other things, and it became huge. And this gentleman, Marcus Joost, at one time was had a net worth of something on the order of $400 million, and he meets his end here. Born in 1961, so just in his early 60s, meets his end here. It's a bit shocking. Someone with that kind of reach and wealth, you would think that they'd find a way to get to Dubai or, get to an extradition country instead of offing themselves. It seems kind of odd. But whatever the case is, his business was accused of doctoring financial statements and lying about. It's kind of like Enron, where they had shell companies and they moved this. There were no real profits, but
Paid little to no tax.
Well, the tax isn't the issue. It's people were, the fooling investors is the claim by claiming profits when there was no profit, actually a loss, going back and forth. That's what Enron was, a bunch of shell companies. That's why I never invested in Enron. A bunch of my friends were like, you should invest in this energy company. It's really amazing. It's in Texas called Enron. So I looked at it and I got their annual statement and I'm reading and I'm like, this doesn't make any sense. There's this part of the company and this part. I had to make a chart and I couldn't even follow it. Subsidiary, and you're in this one paid that one, that one paid that one. Then they claim they made money. It's the same money, just passed to five different people. There's no profit here. And that's apparently what they claim was happening with Steinhoff. And the whole thing fell apart. People lost their pensions, people lost their invested wealth. And there are a lot of angry people at Marcus Justa and Steinhoff. And that's where we are years later. And again, they were a sponsor for the Blitzbach. And they issued this jersey just before the scandal broke. I bought this. And then when I went to Vegas, I was one of the few people on the planet that had one. So anyway, that's kind of what
It
happened.
wasn't,
And he's
yeah,
gone
so it
now.
wasn't a Ponzi scheme. Let me also just
No.
broadly from what I was, so here's an example, right? So Steinhoff would, they wanted to procure all the means for creating furniture, right? So they would want to buy a forest, and then they wanted to cut the wood. Then they wanted to own the transport company that transports the wood. They wanted to own the factory. But there's also a lot of things. So for instance, Pepkor, which is, well, not Cobus Visser, what's his name? Visser, one of the wealthiest people in South Africa. They would buy the company, which would push up their value as Steinhoff, and then they would say, oh, we technically made 3 billion rand profit. And then without actually having the profit, the value of the company would go up, and then the shareholders or some of the shareholders would take the profits. The way that people lost money was that this was a company that was listed on a stock exchange, and a lot of retirement annuities, like your Alan Grays, not saying it's like Alan Gray, but your Alan Grays would invest in that company because it's a safe bet. And because they invested, what would happen is when the price tanked, the people's retirement annuities that were kind of tied to their companies investing in that would be affected. So it wasn't a Ponzi scheme. It was just they went too big and they falsified how big they truly are. And then obviously with Marcus Huerster, what he would do is he would do financials where they don't really would pay 25% company tax. They would find a way to pay 12%, which I think eventually would now have caught up with him with his investigations where Steinhoff would have probably owed the tax man billions and billions and billions of rands.
Well, Steinhoff's collapse wiped $200 billion of market capitalization off the Johannesburg Stock Exchange, something that was really devastating to South Africa's stock market. Of course, this came on the heels of many South African corporations delisting in Johannesburg and relisting in London or New York. That also it wiped off half of the wealth of Christo Visa. He lost half his wealth because he was tied up in this as well. But don't feel bad; he's still a billionaire anyway. And
Yeah, what did
it
he
knocked a
say,
bunch.
like, in that documentary, strangely enough? Like, imagine this, right? So imagine losing close to half of your wealth, and then on TV you say you don't mourn the losses. It's like, dude, you literally wiped out, you probably lost, I don't know, billions of dollars in this deal, and you're like, you don't mourn your losses. You know, I'm like,
Well, he still got billions, so that's his point. But this company, as you said, they get involved a lot of stuff. They tried to buy American mattress manufacturer Sealy back in the day, about 12, 14 years ago, and they got beaten to that by Tempur-Pedic. And so Sealy became Sealy Tempur-Pedic, and they didn't want to be beat again. So they wound up buying Mattress Firm, which is a company that people never heard of. I don't even know they made mattresses, but that's a company that they bought. So look, it's a question of corporate takeovers not being managed properly and the ability to hide things. And this all came tumbling down in December 2017 when the auditors refused to sign the report because, like, we can't validate this. PricewaterhouseCoopers, like, there's no way that we can sign off on this. This doesn't make any sense. And that's when it all went sideways. And here we are, typical, years later, and we're not even a resolution for the Steinhoff scandal. I mean, 2017 and it's 2024. It's like an ANC politician. When
It's
will they
like a
ever be
Jacob
convicted?
Zuma thing going on here.
Yeah, exactly.
Ashley says, saw a clip by Alec Hogg on Biz News today regarding Marcus Huerta. Yeah, I mean, so can I say something about Biz News? That, I mean, I'm pretty sure Biz News has got a phenomenal business model and they do business news really, really well. But Alec Hogg needs to just maybe consider his ties. How do I put this? He must review how much airtime Biz News gives a certain billionaire that is very, very in love with the Patriotic Alliance and Gaetan McKenzie. Because
I think
whenever,
that's somebody that was supposed to be a guest of yours and mine at one point.
and the only reason he wasn't a guest on mine is because I eventually just said, nah, thanks. Biz News just needs to, and Alec Hogg just needs to reconsider being a or being viewed as a mouthpiece for a bored billionaire. That is what I'll say on that, because I respect Biz News. Obviously they played a massive part also in giving the news with regards to Steinhoff and all of that. Just be wary, just be wary of not just becoming a mouthpiece for somebody. Anyway, there was something else that I wanted to talk about. Yeah, the Steinhoff thing is a big thing. Yesterday was Human Rights Day. The load shedding schedule changed very quickly. We've got load shedding at 8 again tonight. And I find it so typical, you know, that the ANC would try their best to keep the lights on during Human Rights Day, and then they failed to do that, which just shows. And I mean, I believe that electricity should be a human right, at least in 2024. It should be something that you at least have access to, you know, to the choice to have it or not. But yet the ANC have failed so dismally. And then you've got, in typical fashion, the ANC that goes on their speeches and says, yeah, you know, so much more people have access to water and have access to electricity. And it's like, yeah, they might have access to it, but what is the quality of the water, firstly? And secondly, no, they don't actually have access to electricity because there's more load shedding now than ever before. And I mean, 6 to 8 hours a day, where previously they would have electricity 24 hours a day. So no. Don't talk bullshit.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that. No, it's there was a comment not along aligned with that, but it was Light Rain earlier talking about Enron being the reason why major electricity markets like Pennsylvania, which export 20% of the export electricity in the entire country comes from my state, why we pay such high rates. No, I disagree, Light Rain. It's not because of Enron and not because of deregulation electricity markets. Deregulation makes it possible for lower rates and a better load balancing system. The problem is not that, it's the intrusion of governments into the private sector. Electricity this has long been a highly regulated marketplace by all the states around the country, and true market-based dynamics do not exist in the electricity market. That's why we pay high rates and why we have electricity failures and why it's so expensive, because of the laws and rules and policies that states make up. Pennsylvanians are paying a high rate for electricity, not because we can't produce electricity, not because we don't have an abundance of cheap energy, which we do, nuclear, coal, natural gas. We're the largest producers of natural gas in the entire country, but because of policy interventions, which are driving up. And the situation could only get worse. The Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, Pennsylvania produces 40% of the carbon emissions of all these northeastern states, because instead of having power plants, they leave the burden to us, and then we have to pay the taxes for the carbon we emit to provide them with electricity. And so we're subsidizing their electricity. Now, that has been declared unconstitutional in December, just a few months ago. But if that gets back on the table, the governor is appealing that. And when I get in the legislature, I will do all I can to prevent that and defeat that legislation, because it's driving up our costs. We should not be paying to subsidize the electricity consumption of people in Massachusetts and New Jersey and New York. They should be paying the true cost by having their own power plants or paying us full fare for the electricity we provide them. And it's the same thing in South Africa. That's the way it should work.
Talking about paying, I haven't seen a super chat on this channel in a very long time. I'll just throw it out there. I think that this is probably going to be the worst month. And to be fair, I haven't asked for super chats. But I mean, the super chat is my super chat game is not that strong this month. It'll be the worst month, I think, in a year and a half that I've had on this channel. I'm not sure how's it going on your side. I understand that people are going through tough times.
Good day yesterday. Yeah, wow. No. But I mean, look, the super chat's going the way of the dodo.
Getting
and Australia and Australian rugby.
Yeah, it's just going down. So I mean, got some extra cash and they would like to give a super chat, I'd greatly appreciate it, just to get some color in the chat section. Yeah. I saw the Powerball tonight is 98 million rand. I think I must play that. I mean, so in your currency, it's like 20 rand or $20.
$20, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Raymond van Beeren, thank you for the super chat. I have to, when a super chat comes in, I have to give it first priority. He says, here's the first one. I think it's going to be the only one, Raymond, but thank you very much for the super chat. It's greatly appreciated. Yeah, we left on salty cracks and sour Steri Stumpies over here. I have to reuse my Steri. You see, I can't even afford Steri Stumpies. I have to use like... secondhand Pepsi or the expiry date.
I think you dropped the Steri Stumpies because you had to get rid of them because they add to the waistline.
They did. I think at my peak was 100 and something kilograms. It was like ridiculous. Alpha One,
look at this.
I know, right? Alpha One, thank you for the 14 rand saying Dar say Hono op Moan. Oh, thank you, Alpha One. You must change your name to 14 Rwant. And then Debbie Moray gave 140 rand, which is 10 times more what Alpha One gave, saying, Father, for the Powerball. No, you can't do that. You see, you can't do that. Because what happens now, you see, like I know Debbie would never ever do it, but now you see, this is where enemies are made, right? You give money and you say it's for the Powerball. Now I go and buy a ticket and I win the Powerball. Then I've got 20 Debbie Morays tomorrow that contacts me and says, hello, Ronaldo. Listen, what's going on over here? You know? Well, but thank you very much for the super chats. It's greatly appreciated. Keep it coming. Please, keep it coming.
I would play that Powerball, but it's not enough. I need 107 million to buy that mansion in Constantia that's up for sale. It's 100. Maybe I can make an offer, 98 million.
Well, I think maybe you're probably going to ask them to put it up a bit so you can get a tax break there. By the way, I just saw now on, because I'm just also looking at XQuick, because there was something that I wanted to talk about on Wednesday already, but like there's so much news breaking. Did you watch the Helen Ziller interview? Apparently it's fire on Masha Bela. I think she was on Masha Bela. I'm just looking at what it says here at the bottom. But yeah, Helen is stirring the pot because she did a podcast or interview in which people are now losing their minds, which tells me she probably spoke a lot of truth on it and people aren't happy with her.
No, I didn't see that. I haven't seen much news on Helen of late and I don't follow her as closely as I used to. It's harder to do because she's in a less prominent public position than she used to be. So keeping
And she
track of
has
her
calmed
movement
down with
needed.
her tweets, let's be real.
Yeah, I mean, then that was one of the few ways you could follow what she was up to when she was doing all the tweets, but she has calmed down. So it's hard to keep up with Helen, and I don't have that relationship like Ramon does or you do where I could get her. So I don't really know what's going on with her, but she's still a fascinating politician and someone of great skill and accomplishment that people ought to pay attention to and not take for granted. What is interesting to me is that South Africa's Jewish community, other than the Board of Deputies, has been relatively quiet, in my view. Maybe they're just keeping their heads down over the anti-Semitism that's spread all over South Africa. It's very frightening, and maybe that's why, of course, Helen, of course, is Jewish. That's why I mentioned that. So.
Yeah, I don't really have a comment other than just people are at the moment riding a trend, whether they believe it's right or wrong, or whether truly it's right or wrong. They're just following a trend at the moment. Just like, we know what happens with trends. That's why it's called trends. The truth will eventually come out. People will eventually then just deny that they either supported it or that they felt so strongly about it, or they'll just keep on fighting against it and acting like, it's something that they've stood up for all this time. So, yeah, don't forget the
Yep.
draw. Actually, let me do the draw
Yeah, let's
quick
do
if
that
you don't
now.
mind.
Yep. Yeah, let's do it
Let
now.
me, okay, so let me, how do I
You
do
know,
this?
your
So,
shirt, the shirt you're wearing looks like you're in the barber shop with one of those bibs they put over to catch all the hair. Oh, there we go. Okay. I couldn't see that. All I could see was like the flowers on
it's not a
it.
flower, it's the actual alien from Stranger Things.
Oh, is it? Okay. I don't
Yeah.
watch Stranger Things.
Oof, you're missing out. It's oh, by the way, not sure if you saw the and listen, it's not a remake, it's the actual sequel. Beetlejuice 2.
Okay.
Listen, I was very skeptical when I heard that they're gonna do it, but that trailer gave me goosebumps because when I was a kid, I haven't watched Beetlejuice in probably about 20, 25 years. But when I was a kid, I watched Beetlejuice and it scared the bejeebies out of me. Well, it, because when you're that
Yeah.
young, so.
No, I'm not laughing at you. I'm just because it's
No,
true. It was a
but
scary
so
movie.
Winona Ryder and then the. What's the la the girl's name that played Wednesday Addams? She's in it. And then, of course, the main actor whose name now I'll
Michael
forget.
Keaton.
Michael Keaton, and it looks like he's just like it looked like he played Beetlejuice yesterday. That's the good thing when the makeup is so terrible or it makes you look so bad that you can just put it back on and it looks like you haven't aged a day. So be sure to check it out, the trailer for it, and let me know what you think. Oh, and then another thing before we do the draw, House of the Dragon, for those of you that watch Game of Thrones, they did their marketing team needs a raise because they so for those of you that don't know, House of Dragons is pretty much this family fighting over who actually is in charge of that house and or that kingdom. And now what they've done for the second season is they've done Team Green and Team Black. So they've made this like sort of which house do you stand behind of who actually the kingdom belongs to. So brilliant marketing. And I Sorry, I have to give credit where it's due when it comes to marketing. And I went to go and watch Dune for a second time, by the way. It's brilliant. I would
I'm not
highly
that familiar.
recommend.
I'm
Have
not
you
that
watched the
familiar
first
with
one?
that. No. I bet I've read the original Dune, but I'm with the House of Dragons. I mean, I stand firmly behind
Clever.
Gryffindor.
Okay, let me drag this over here quick. I'm just checking. Everybody that gave me a super chat, I mean, it was just Arbot, right? Let me just do
Debbie gave
this.
one. Debbie gave one.
Okay, so Debbie, to please, no, not the super chats now. I'm talking about, okay, let me
Oh,
just do this.
previously.
So,
Okay.
who all year that, I mean, Arbot gave a 200. Like, is there anybody that I'm missing? Ashley, I'll get to your super chat now. I'm just going to do the draw quick. Was there anybody that gave a super chat for Mel to be added? I need to know about that. By the way, we're going to do a draw now for people that gave Mel S a contribution to her sister. And the person that gets drawn here will get a 2,000 rand tech hamper to the value of 2,000 rand. If not, I've put everybody that Mel gave me the names for, And so it's Graham, it's Raymond, it's Des, it's Arbot, it's Gerhardus, it's Wouter. And then obviously the amount of times that they, every 100 rand they got one entry. So, Chris, I'm going to ask you, how many times must I shuffle this?
Three.
Three times. So
Yep.
shuffle, shuffle, and shuffle. All right. I remember the last time this was so hilarious when I did that, because I think the one person that he had one entry and everybody else like gave so many entries, and then it was like almost it like almost fell on just that one entry. Okay, so I'm gonna click to spin. Here we go. Who's gonna win the 2,000 rand tech? Des. Is it? Yes, Des. Congratulations, Des. You have won yourself the 2,000 rand tech hamper. Congratulations. Yes, congratulations. There we go. So reach out to me. Send me proof that you made the contribution to renhos@gmail.com. And then yeah, we will get that prize to you. Sorry to all everybody else that lost. You are all a bunch of losers. Sorry for that. Try
Well,
harder
that was
next
to be all
time.
the people that didn't hit the thumbs up on this broadcast.
Yeah, it must be that, you know. So yeah, there was a super chat earlier from Ashley Engelbrecht, who's it's her first super chat. So well done, Ashley. Thank you for your very first super chat saying, okay, Colonel is next. What happened? So your very first super chat is a super chat to me, and then you say, okay, Colonel is next. I've got no idea what that is in reference to. Maybe Ashley, if you can give context. Maybe it was something we said earlier, and now it's just not. Mel says, thank you to everyone who entered. Really made a difference. Ronaldo, thank you for the prize. Much appreciated. Thank you for all for caring. Only a pleasure, Mel. Thank you very much. She's been a member for 45 months, by the way. Thanks, Mel. And I hope that it made a little bit of a difference at least. All right. We've got 10 more minutes and then I have to end the stream because of the dreaded load shedding. It's amazing how people in this country just got used to it, eh?
Yep, that's look. I mean, I saw this. I predicted this with load shedding and so many other things because to me, it became very clear how resilient South Africans, in particular, are humans in general, but South Africans in particular. In 2000, I was at Charles de Gaulle Airport. We were flying and had to turn back because of engine problem. That's never a good thing, but at least we landed safely. And we were stuck in the terminal at Charles de Gaulle, and all the shops were closed, just hanging around. And there were a number of South Africans there, and there were some American tourists, and I'm an American, you know, obviously they heard me talking. So we started chatting and talking about going to South Africa, and they asked, well, is it safe to go to South? This is 2000. I said, safe to go to South Africa. I said, well, listen, going to South Africa is being a tourist is like being a tourist anywhere. You got to make sure you don't stand out. You know, you don't want to make it obvious that you're out of place. You got to have your spidey sense about you. As long as you do, you should be okay. I mean, you know, there's always pickpockets and crime, but if you're not in the wrong place at the wrong time, if you're not, you know, doing the wrong things and you pay attention to your surroundings, you should be fine. And but I said, yeah, it is a dangerous place. A lot of people get killed there. It's sad, but it's true. And then the South Africans, ah, no, that's no. And then we start talking. In the course of talking, they all there was mostly white folks, couple color, and they're like, it's no big deal. And they're like, oh, so they start talking. Oh yeah, this is where I got stabbed when they carjacked me. That scar right there. This lady lifts up her trousers. This is where I got shot in the shin when they tried to carjack me. Oh
It's
yeah,
like,
no,
oh, yeah, I know
I was,
this one.
yeah. They tried to rape me in my house. This is where I got shot in the stomach. I'm like, what the? My point was they had become inured to violent crime because it was so prevalent. And that was 23 years ago, 24 years ago. Imagine how many people are today. It's something you live with and you adapt and accept it, but it's not acceptable. 85 people a day murdered, gender-based violence, no electricity, no potable water, cholera. How embarrassing is that for an industrial country to have cholera? This is not normal. We are
No.
now having outbreaks of leprosy in Florida because of this uncontrolled migration into this country. This is insane. These things were defeated long ago, and South Africa shouldn't be in this mess. The ANC is responsible.
So, okay, quickly. Ashley says, "No, I've been waiting to give super chats on Colonel's channel, but tonight I finally managed to change my password to do it." So she says, "I'm getting a super chat, and then you are next, Colonel." So thank you
Oh,
very
that's
much
what
for
it was.
that,
I'm getting the next
Ashley.
super chat.
Yeah,
Okay.
but
Thanks,
remember,
Ashley.
Ashley, like your rands are worth more here in South Africa. You know, like when Chris gets like a 35 rand super chat for him, that's like he can't even like get up to go and cash that because it's worthless. So your money is better spent, yeah, you know, in South
Yeah.
Africa. You know, keep
Let's
it.
remember that I spend a lot of time in South Africa and I use rands.
I'm just joking. So yeah, with regards to the, I think South Africa is one of the most beautiful countries in the world, and I think that if you just stick to the tourist kind of places, which is where the overwhelming majority of South Africans spend their time, I think you're relatively safe. I mean, Nelson Mandela Bay, as an example, is now considered the most violent city in South Africa and the ninth in the world. And I
Worse
can
than the Cape
honestly,
Flats?
well, yeah, according to a recent
Wow.
study, remember, we've
Wow.
got there's a lot of violent crime in the northern areas here, and specifically in a bunch of townships in Nelson Mandela Bay. So they go on what the police stats show. So if you had to ask me on my everyday lived experience in Nelson Mandela Bay, whether I think that this is the most violent city in South Africa, no, not at all. So is it dangerous? Of course. Are you more at risk of being raped or murdered or stabbed or, you know, just any crime? Probably. But you kind of like you get built in a different way in South Africa. You built differently, and like you can die as easily as anybody else, but it's just like a thing in your head that kind of not blocks it out, but you're just more aware of it. Like, you know, looking when somebody walks behind you. If you drive at night and there's a car that for like more than 5 minutes is following you, you become aware of it. You like so it you just pick up on things differently. But I think that, you know, people should at least if they, especially if they do travel a lot, they should visit South Africa at least once. I think that because it's a beautiful country with a lot of diversity and a lot of different cultures and a lot of different great things to experience, but it's definitely not safe. By the way, before I forget, happy birthday to Cameron Heslop for tomorrow, and our dear designer tech Warren, enjoy celebrating your day. Yes, definitely. Warren hasn't been here in a while. I hope that he's doing all right. But yeah, happy birthday to Cameron for tomorrow and to Warren, definitely.
So those crime-ridden townships that are north of PE, would those be the ones on the way back from Uitenhage?
Yeah, so
So that would be the route that you have me come to the DA rally and I had to go back to PE.
no, like Uitenhage. I mean, you're driving on the highway and on, well, on this, not the highway, but the
I'm
main
just
route.
teasing. I'm just teasing. No,
Hey,
that's
dude,
funny.
I mean, you've been in war-torn countries for you. It's like, it's
Exactly.
literally just
Exactly.
like another day.
Actually, the day that I came back from there, after the DA had their rally, it was a Women's Day. What were we there for? I can't remember. I forget what that rally was. And that's when Andrew Whitfield came down there. So, but anyway, whatever the rally was, when I came back from there and I went, I think it might have been Women's Day last year. But anyway, when I went down to towards PE from there, after you get past the VW plant and you're down the road a bit past that, there were like 40 cop cars in the middle between the road, because you got two lanes on each side, divide highway. And I don't know what they were doing. They were massing for something. I don't know if they're going to go raid a township or whatever, but I was like, whoa, if you're looking for cops, this is the place to be. And there were a lot of them out there. So.
Well, tomorrow you're going to also see a lot of police vehicles in Nelson Mandela Bay because Squirrel is visiting Nelson Mandela Bay tomorrow, and he's
Oh.
addressing people at the Feather Market Hall at, what was it, 5 p.m.? No, sorry, 3 p.m. Yes.
All right,
So
so
tomorrow there's going to be a lot of blue lights. I'm assuming if he's, I don't think he's sleeping over because I would have heard it in my ward. Because I bet you he's going to stay at the nicest hotel in Nelson Mandela Bay, which is in my ward. But yeah, so
all
tomorrow
right.
he's here in Nelson Mandela Bay to beg people to vote for him, even though they haven't delivered anything over the last,
30
I don't know,
years.
Yeah. So, by the way, do yourself a favor and watch the speech by Thabo Mbeki if you haven't yet. 45
Is the one where he
minutes.
criticized?
Yeah, it's the one where he talks about the three different time periods in South Africa, like 94 to 2007, 2007 until 22, and then I think 23 onwards. So yeah, be sure to check out that speech. You can find it on YouTube because I'm actually almost done with it now, watching it on YouTube.
So tonight, if you hear this over the radio, folks, reporting live from Nelson Mandela Bay, this is V and Vuta, and we have a hippo alert.
Roaming the streets and very
That's right.
dangerous. Keep
And
your wallets.
BMW 735i's $10,000 suits. It's a hippo alert. Be on the lookout.
Yeah, and make sure that your handbags are held tightly and your wallets are secured in your pockets.
Exactly. All
Anyway,
righty, we probably should wrap it up here.
yeah, be sure to subscribe to Chris. Link in the description below. He does. Is there any rugby this weekend?
Yeah, there is, but because I need a campaign, I'm only going to do a single game, and that game will be the Stormers game. I'll be covering Stormers versus Edinburgh. So the rest of them, I'm gonna have to forego because I have to go out and knock on doors.
Yeah, so the
But
link
that's
is in the
tomorrow.
description below, but then also he's got a Rugby Ascendant channel, which I always forget to add, but one of my moderators will post it in the chat. So if you enjoy rugby and you want to find better commentary, then what you can do is you can literally put the volume down on your television set and you can just open it up on the laptop or open it up on your phone and listen to what he's got to say. And it is, look, I don't think it's better than the Osa co commentary. But then again, I don't understand that Xhosa commentary. I can just pick up the passion. Thank you, Hendo, for posting. So you can also go and subscribe to him there. Thank you to everybody that gave a super chat. Thank you for the membership chats. And yes, I need to go and play the Powerball quickly before it's 8 o'clock and before it's load shedding. So, Chris, any last words from your side?
No, just have a good weekend, folks. And for those of you who show up for the Stormers game tomorrow, I'll see you there. Other folks, I'll catch you on the next broadcast. Thanks a lot, Ronaldo. And thanks for tuning in on a Friday, folks, for our belated Wednesdays with the Colonel. It's always a
Yeah, I
pleasure.
believe we had 120 people at one time. So, maybe it should become a belated or maybe a Fridays with the Colonel. I don't
We'll have to see. We'll have to see.
know.
All
I
right.
have to
Cool
check.
beans. All right.
All right. Have a good one, everybody. Till later. Cheers and peace out.